So again, thank you so much for the invitation. Thank you so much for the introduction. Talking today about comparing EMC standards. Now, there's this huge wide universe of EMC standards out there. It is a complex ecosystem. This is just a small screenshot of a small portion of a list of EMC standards from Todd Hubing's website, learnemc.com. And you can see already it's just this, you know, page after page after page of standards. Obviously, in half an hour to 40 minutes, I can't cover all of them. I can't say what applies to your hardware specifically. But what I really want to focus on is how to make sure that of the standards you're looking at, that you are applying them correctly for your product. And, you know, where can you sort of take a test done for one standard and maybe apply it to a different regulatory environment? And where can you not do that? So as Roland mentioned, you know, I've had an opportunity to work at NASA Johnson Space Center. That's really where I got my start in EMC. I've also worked on Dream Chaser. That's going to come up a little bit later because Dream Chaser was a composite spacecraft. I was a test director at Northrop Grumman for MIL Standard 461 testing. Troubleshooting at Ford Motor Company was pretty much my favorite part of the job. Getting that kind of hands-on experience really gave me a better sense of how all the theoretical and abstract physics and electrical engineering plays out in the real world. I worked for a computational simulation modeling company, which has been, which was a very eye-opening. But for them, I was mostly doing project management. So just last year, I went out on my own. I founded EMC United and getting more and more opportunities to help a wide array of clients, but also do more education opportunities like what DENPAFLUX is offering here. As I've been bouncing around between aerospace, defense, automotive, back to defense, and then getting a broader exposure with consumer electronics and medical devices, I got really interested in why the standards are written the way they are, right? We're all looking at the same physics, we're all looking at the same electrical engineering, but the standards are written very differently for different industries. And so I actually went out of my way to try and join more standards working groups to get a better sense of how standards come together and why they're written the way they're written. And also, as time's gone on, I'd often been frustrated by standards that I felt were not clearly written. And ever so slowly, I'm starting to hopefully have an impact on trying to write them in a way that is a little bit more user-friendly, if that makes sense. So once I started seriously geeking out about standards and learning more about that world, I ended up in the role that I currently have, which is Vice President of Standards for the IEEE EMC Society. So I'll make a pitch at the end for ways that you also, if this is a topic of particular interest to you, can get involved in the standards development process. So I always like to start here with what I call the EMC fire triangle, even though my fire triangle looks more like an oval. So I call it the EMC fire triangle because a lot of us learned as kids that to have a fire, you need three things. You need fuel and a heat source and oxygen. And if you can take away one of those things, you've put out the fire. So if you have a small fire and you smother it with a blanket, you're effectively taking away the oxygen and putting it out. If you pour water on it, you're essentially taking away the heat and putting it out. Well, to have an EMC problem, you need three things. You need a noisy source, a sensitive victim, and a coupling path between them. And that coupling path can either be over the air by radiation or conducted through shared electrical wiring. And when you look at the way the EMC standards are written, they kind of treat this as four quadrants. So if you're trying to quiet down the source, you're looking at radiated emissions or conducted emissions testing. And if you're trying to make sure that the victim is robust enough, you're looking at radiated immunity or susceptibility, and then the same for conducted. Of course, then there's ESD. ESD, you know, usually ends up being part of EMC testing, just mostly because it's very convenient to do in an EMC lab. ESD is a little interesting because it has elements of both conducted and radiated immunity to it, but we'll talk a little bit more about that in later slides. So what we want to do for overall EMC success, because it is actually possible to pass EMC testing the first time. It's maybe not common, but you know, the more planning we put up front, the more attention we pay to the design with the EMC best practices in mind, the more likely we are to have that success. So if we can design the PCBs with EMC best practices in mind, and then we're going to take those PCBs and put them in specific modules, design the modules with the EMC best practices in mind, we want to test that box that everything's in. We want to test that, you know, very strictly and pass those tests. That gives us some confidence that when we integrate everything together in a system, that we've got the best chance of everything playing nice together and meeting all the regulatory requirements. But that's not the end of it, because if you're going to take a module and integrate it into something larger, you know, whether that's, you know, satellite or an aircraft or a car, we need to package the modules with EMC best practices in mind. Cable harness and routing is incredibly important for this. We need to design our grounding and bonding schemes for the whole system with EMC best practices in mind. And then ideally we test at the integrated product level and we pass. This is one of the other reasons Raul was asking right up front of sort of why EMC, why did I go into it? The fact that it is so much of a systems level discipline has really been fascinating to me. So when I was the EMC engineer for the Dream Chaser spacecraft, I made sure to not only have close contact with the electrical team, but also the folks doing cable routing, with also the structures team, the mechanical team, the materials and processes folks, as well as the overall systems engineers. I got to talk to people, you know, who were involved in every aspect of the spacecraft, because it all can matter for EMC performance. So overall, you know, what we say in the aircraft, sort of military and spacecraft world, is test like you fly. But you know, for automotive, test like you drive, or just test like you operate. Because when you're looking at all these different standards, the thing to keep in mind, what they're all trying to achieve, is to ensure that your unit will be successful at operating in its operational environment, whatever that is, and that it won't cause problems to other things in its environment, no matter what those are, right? So CISPR 25, MIL standard 461, and FCC, which you can also, FCC uses the ANSI C63-4 test method. It's very similar to CISPR 32 testing for Europe or other international agencies. They are all have test methods for testing a module or a standalone component for radiated emissions. So again, trying to control the source. But they're going to do that in different ways. The first thing that's different between them is that CISPR 25 and MILSTAN 461 have a test antenna 1 meter away from the thing being tested, unit under test. The FCC method has the antenna 3 to 10 meters away. Now, testing this close at 1 meter has some well-known downsides. The tests are less repeatable. They are a little less reliable is probably not the right word, but especially at the low end of the frequency range, you are more likely to find yourself testing in the near field. So the correlations of everything aren't quite as stable as they are farther away. But there is a reason why we make that trade-off for CISPR 25 and MIL standard 461. That's because this is made for modules that are going to go on cars, and this is made for modules that are going to go on tanks or sailing vessels or spacecraft or satellites or aircraft. They're all meant for an environment where you're going to have a lot of things, a lot of electronics units packed in a relatively tight space. And so because we can't guarantee that any particular source victim pair will be far away from each other, we establish this relatively close testing distance to try and capture those interactions as accurately as possible. Now, No testing can ever capture every single interaction that might happen, but this has approach for automotive and military has or aerospace and defense has proven to be fairly successful over the years.